It's my pleasure and honor this night to welcome Professor Mohamed Abou El-Ghar, Professor of Radiology at Urology and Nephrology Center, Mansoura University, to speak about the basics of MRI and kidney. And this is, I think, one of the most important presentations, this part and the second part, and we'll announce on the second part as soon as possible for the advanced and the advanced technology in MRI and nephrology and urinary tract. So, Professor Abou El-Ghar, this is the date of birth, 1966. He's a consultant diagnostic radiology at Urology and Nephrology Center, as well as vice director of the center. He has fellowship of European Society of Urogenital Radiology, member of European Society of Radiology, member of Radiology Society of North America, member of Egyptian Society of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine, member of editorial board of the World Journal of Radiology, reviewer of European Radiology Journal, reviewer of the World Journal of Radiology, reviewer of Arab Journal of Urology, reviewer of the British Journal of Radiology, associate editor of Egyptian Journal of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine, reviewer of the American Journal of Nephrology. So this is a prestigious chair, and I'd like to share with you the total harvest of his achievements in research. He has 162 articles that, as you see, cited more than 2,000 times with total H index 26, which is a very prestigious value of, as a researcher. And the most contribute topics, all the urogenital tract and mostly in the MRI. Professor Abou El-Ghar shared with us with the SNT since the beginning of the our activities in CME of Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation. This is 7 years back, and this is last year when he spoke about the novel imaging techniques in renal transplantation. It is my honor and a privilege to introduce Professor Abou El-Ghar to start his journey in the basics of MRI and the kidney. Professor Abou El-Ghar.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Hello everybody. I would like to thank Professor Hussein for giving me this chance to chair his learning activities for nephrology or the nephrology doctors. Today, as Professor Hussein introduced me, we will discuss the basics of MRI of the kidney. First, before we discussing the basics of MRI, we would like to give just a short hint about how we imaging techniques, how we use imaging techniques for radiation imaging, such as conventional imaging or plain X-ray imaging. There is a tube that is a source of radiation here, and then after activation of the tube, there is a radiation goes from the tube, and we receive the radiation on a blade or on a detector here, or at CT, we can see here there is a tube, X-ray tube, and there is a detector receiving the X-ray after passing from the body of the patient. But MRI is different. MRI, there is no radiation. And so how MRI machine works? MRI machine works by creating a magnetic field, high magnetic field that sends radio waves, what's called radio frequency pulses, through the body, and then measures the response with a computer. This creates an image or picture of the inside of our body that is much clearer than can be obtained with most other methods. MR depends upon excitation and relaxation. We use this large or huge magnet of MRI. This is a huge magnet used for excitation. It works upon the protons. Most of our body, about more than 70% of the body, contains water. And so, MRI, the magnet, when there is this the water protons inside the water is at resting position. We can see here, this is the protons aligned regularly. Each one is directed in a different directions. But when we do excitation or using the magnet here, as we can see here, there will be an alignment of the protons inside the water here. This is the proton atoms here. We can see this aligned either in a longitudinal direction, either to up or down here. So after magnetization, the protons will be aligned longitudinally, either at the up or down here. As we can see here, this is a large magnet here of the MR here, as we can see, and it will lead to alignment of the proton water protons in a single direction, in a longitudinal direction, either up or downward, as we can see here. After going our off of the magnet, there will be relaxation of the protons. It will return to its normal position and will lead to loss of its power, and this power will be taken by the computer and will create the image of MRI. So this is basically, this is the basics or physics of MRI. As we can see here, these are very simple. The physics of MRI is very, very complicated, but as we can see, after alignment of the, after excitation of the protons here, and then we getting off the magnet, and it will return to its normal position. It will lose its power, and after getting the power, we will get the images, either what's called T1 or T2 relaxation time. According to the timing of getting the image, it will be give me us either the T1 or T2 weighted images, as we can see here simply. To differentiate between T1 and T2 weighted images, we mainly depends upon the sensitivity of the load. This is the load here, as you can see, the CCF here is black or dark here, and this is the T1. But the CCF is high signal, as we can see here, it is high signal. This is the T2 weighted images. T1 mainly used for anomalies, but mainly we use the T2 as it is the best technique for evaluation of the body. So T1 used for evaluation, and also for characterization of the content of the lesions, as we will see after some time. Why we speaking about what is the advantage of MRI? What is why the increasing role of MRI nowadays in evaluation of ionized elements? First, MRI is of no utilization of ionizing radiation. This is number one. Number two is multiple capabilities. We can do either coronal, sagittal, or axial images at MRI in the planes. Third is excellent anatomical resolution, as a high soft tissue contrast in comparison to other imaging modalities, including the CT. So the advantages of MRI, no radiation, no on its excellent anatomical and soft tissue resolution. So before sending patient to do MRI, I first check that the patient have no cardiac pacemaker, no catheter, with metallic artificial prosthesis, and no metallic implantation. Nowadays, most prosthesis or most of the pacemaker in the new materials is compatible with MRI. But I should be sure before sending patient that he have no contraindication of MRI. So what about the MRI network of the kidney, T1 weighted MRI, and this is the T2 weighted MRI, and again, this is slightly here high signal intensity, while the CSF here is of low signal intensity. This is the kidney, and this is the axial cut, and we can see here, this is the kidney, this is the left kidney, this is the right kidney, this is the liver here, and I can see at the T1 weighted MRI, I can see this is the medulla, this is the cortex, it is gray, or intermediate signal intensity, the cortex, the medulla is of low signal intensity. I can see the blood vessel here, what is called, it is black, and what's called signal void. This is the moving blood appear here, black here. So at MRI without contrast, I will see the blood vessel. This is the flowing blood here. If normal flow of blood inside the vessel, it will be appear here, black, or what's called signal vessel. This is the cortex, and this is the medulla. At T2, I can see this is the kidney here, and this is also the signal void blood vessel here. This is the aorta, this is the IVC, this is the renal veins. but it is difficult to differentiate between the cortex and the medulla at the T2-weighted image. It is both appears as intermediate signal intensity here. It is normal. Normal to see this is the cortex and the medulla of intermediate signal intensity here. This is a different phases of MRI after injection of contrast. This is the coronal images at contrast. This is the cortex here. This is the medulla. This is a corticomedullary differentiation here between the cortex and the medulla. This is the early phases of post-contrast MRI. This is the cortex. This is the medulla. Here, this is the late corticomedullary phase here. Also, the contrast started to go to the medulla. And this is the nephrographic phase here after excretion of contrast from the cortex to the medulla. And this is no differentiation between the cortex and the medulla at nephrographic phase. So this is the early corticomedullary phase. This is the late corticomedullary phase. And this is the nephrographic phase after injection of contrast. This is the phases of MRI with contrast or after gadolinium excretion. What is the uses of MRI in the kidney? Simply, we will discuss how MRI differentiate between the general pathology of the kidney, between the simple cyst, the complicated cyst, the renal tumor, benign or malignant, benign tumors such as angiomyolipoma or malignant such as renal cell carcinoma, if there is a hematoma of the, in the kidney after or aneurysm, especially after biopsy or trauma or something like that, and also in cases of renal infection. This is the common indication. This is a routine examination for routine use of MRI. At T2, as we said, T2 used for a pathological evaluation of the kidney. At T2, if the signal intensity is black, as we said, it is the flowing blood. As we said, that's the rapid flowing blood, either at T1 or T2 will appear as black. Also, air and the calcium and the bone will appear black. If there is a low signal intensity, as we see, can see here, is the gray. So in the cases of the tendons, the ligaments, pancreas, and the liver, intermediate signal intensity as adrenal and the muscle and cartilage, and high signal intensity is usually, as we said, in the fluid CSF, urinary bladder with urine, gallbladder and with fluid inside, and kidney with hydronephrosis. So high signal intensity at T2, it means it is usually a fluid. Intermediate, usually it is a soft tissue or organs, tissue organs. Low signal intensity usually in the muscle and the ligaments, and the black, it is an ear or calcium or bone. This is an example of T2. T2 simply, I can diagnose this is a simple cyst here. The cyst with a smooth thin wall here with high signal intensity content inside of the fluid. It is a simple cyst and nothing more to do. It is a simple cyst here, and this is a smooth outline with clear fluid content inside. It is a simple cyst, as we can see here at U1-weighted image. But if the fluid content altered or is abnormal signal intensity, such as this lesion here of intermediate signal intensity or even low signal intensity, or this is a cystic lesion here with multiple septation, it is a complicated cyst. This lesion here, as we can see, it is an intermediate signal intensity. This is a clear fluid here of the gallbladder, high signal. But this is lesion of intermediate signal intensity. It may be a soft tissue. It may be a cyst with abnormal fluid content, such as an infection or such as hemorrhage inside. This is a cyst of low signal intensity, lesion of low signal intensity here. But this is a simple cyst here. The lesion of signal intensity may be a hemorrhagic or maybe a soft tissue mass. This is here a cystic lesion with abnormal signal intensity. It may be a complicated cyst, maybe a malignant cyst, as we can we'll see. Later an application of CT. So T2 will detect the pathology of that there is a pathology of the kidney, and we will do a further evaluation such as using T2, using contrast, using diffusion-weighted image to characterize the lesion. So this is a simple cyst, but this is a different pathology here at the kidneys can be detected at T2-weighted MRI. T2 used, as we said, for anatomical, but if I need to characterize the lesions, if there is a complicated cyst, maybe hemorrhage, infection, or septation, T2 may add for evaluation of and characterization of the lesion. If there is a lesion containing fat such as angiomyolipoma, the fat will have a special character at T1 and T2 melanin containing lesion or high protein containing cyst. It will be appear of high signal intensity at T2 and used also T1 we can use in characterization of adrenal masses. At T1, if the fluid will appear as of low signal intensity. At T1, fluid will be appear of low signal intensity, but at air and calcium as in T2 will appear black. Of low signal intensity will be the fluid. So the fluid will appear as low signal intensity at T1 and high signal intensity at T2. If there is intermediate signal intensity, it will be suspicious for a high protein containing lesion such as abscesses or complicated cyst. High signal intensity, it will be in fat or in blood or after injection of gadolinium, the lesion, enhancing lesion will appear as a high signal intensity. This is at T1. Of the kidney, and we can see here this is a cyst here of low signal fluid, simple cyst here of low signal intensity at T1. This is another cyst here of low signal intensity at T1. So fluid at signal or at T1 of low signal intensity. If I have lesion with high signal intensity here at T1, it may be a blood or maybe a fat. We will use a special technique, what's called T1 or T2 is fat suppression to differentiate between blood and hemorrhage. So this lesion of high signal intensity, it may be fat or the lesion or hemorrhage inside the lesion. This is a cyst with high signal intensity or intermediate signal intensity. It's a complicated cyst here. It may be infected. It may be a hemorrhagic cyst. Also, this is a small lesion. This is a soft tissue mass appears here at T1 as intermediate signal intensity and enhancing after injection of contrast at T1. This technique, what's called T1 with fat, or this is at T1 with fat suppression. We can see this is the lesion that show before. This is the lesion with high signal intensity. We do a special technique, what's called T1 with fat suppression. If the lesion there is a drop of signal intensity, as we can see here, this is the area of high signal intensity at T1 here. This is a conventional T1. If this become suppressed or become dark here, this means that lesion is fat. It is a case of angiomyolipoma or fat containing tumor. So if the lesion become suppressed, as we can see here, it is a fat containing lesion. So this is a lesion at T1 with high signal intensity here. And after doing fat suppression, we can see there is drop of signal intensity. It is a fat containing lesion. We can see also the subcutaneous fat become black here. This is a subcutaneous fat here of high signal intensity here, but it becomes suppressed. So this technique called fat suppression technique or T1 with fat suppression technique that used to differentiate between fat and other content mimics fat such as blood. We have another techniques used also in imaging of or used at MRI beside T1 and T2. T1 and T2 is the basic techniques, but we have different other different sequences such as gradient echo sequence. This is a sequence of short scan time used mainly for doing MRI with a contrast. It can cover the kidney in about 20 seconds with a single breath hold. It used to do contrast enhancing MR for the different organs. The drawbacks is a susceptibility artifact in case of methemoglobin. If there's a hemoglobin, it will appear as dark or black in the gradient image. But this technique used mainly for evaluation, for doing MRI with contrast for the different organs. This is an example for MRI of the kidney. This is a renal lesion here we can see this is the T1 here with fat suppression before injection of contrast. This is a lesion with this is a lesion here with intermediate signal intensity at the upper bowl of the kidney here. And this lesion, this is an axial view here. And this is after injection of contrast here. This is the gradient sequence used for injection. This is before injection of gadolinium. And this is after injection of gadolinium. We can note this is a small enhancing lesion inside this cyst. This is a complicated cyst with altered fluid content. And this is a small enhancing nodule inside. It is a complicated or malignant cyst. It is a small enhancing nodule. It is a malignant cyst. We can do at MRI do also direct coronal images. As we said, this is a multiplanar capabilities. We can do sagittal, coronal, or other or axial images. And we can see this is a nodule here at the upper bowl of this cyst. This is other kidney, the right kidney. We can show this, it is a small in size. And this is an enhancing goal of the renal pelvis indicates that this is chronic bionephritic changes at the kidney. It is an example for a common disease we can see at the nephrology department. It is a case of polycystic kidney. But what is this? This is a T1. As we can see, this image is T1. This image is T1. The fluid here, as you can see, CSF is black here. So it is T1. This is the T2. We can see the cyst here, the fluid, the CSF is high. We can see here the cyst is high signal intensity and of low signal intensity at T1. So at T1, the cyst, the fluid is low signal intensity. And at T2, this is the cyst here, the fluid is of high signal intensity. This is an axial images, and this is the coronal image. This is the enlarged kidneys here. We can see the kidney extends to the iliac fossa here. But what is this? What is this dark lesion here at T2 and of intermediate mixed high and low signal intensity here? What is this lesion? This is a complicated cyst. It is a hemorrhage inside the cyst, hemorrhage of different ages of high, mixed high and low signal intensity at T1, mixing of acute and subacute blood here at T1. And it is of low signal intensity at T2, as we can see here. So it is a blood, this is a hemorrhage inside the cyst here. This is a large cyst, large hemorrhagic cyst. A large cyst complicated by hemorrhage inside with different blood ages inside. So it is a case of polycystic kidney with large cyst with hemorrhage inside. And we can see also here, this is multiple cysts with altered fluid signal intensity. Mostly it is a hemorrhage also inside or high protein fluid content. But definitely this, it is a cyst here with blood inside, as we can see high signal intensity, mixed high and low signal intensity, and low signal intensity at T2. So it is, this is a polycystic kidney disease with hemorrhage inside, a cyst at the right kidney here. And the other cysts, some of the other cysts shows altered fluid content, suggesting it may be high proteinaceous fluid content inside the cysts. This is another example of a kidney with a lesion here inside. Here, this is a posterior aspect of the left kidney shows this is a large lesion posterior. This is a T1. This is a CF. CSF here is of low signal intensity. What CSF here of high signal intensity is a gallbladder of high signal. It is a T2. Here, the gallbladder of low signal. It is a T1. And at T2, we can see this is a heterogeneous lesion here. It is a tumor with necrosis inside and mixed necrotic tissue and soft tissue component. So it is a renal mass, and at coronal also T2 weighted MRI, we can see here, this is a lesion of heterogeneous signal intensity. It is a renal tumor. And after injection of contrast, we can see this is also the lesion enhancing, but lesser than the normal renal parenchyma. And after injection of contrast, we can see another lesion at the other kidney, at the right kidney. This is a vessel. After injection of contrast, we can see vessels of high signal intensity, while at T1 and T2, the vessels of low signal intensity or signal void or black, it is a flowing blood inside the vessels. This is another example here. We can see here, this is T1 and T2 weighted image. This is a large kidney with a lesion of high signal intensity here at T1 and T2 with the at coronal images. This is a lesion inside. This is after fat suppression. As we said, we lesion of high signal intensity at T1 and T2 suggest fat or blood. And so we do technique what is called T1 with fat suppression. This is a T1 with fat suppression, and the fat inside the lesion or the areas of high signal intensity at T1 here becomes black here, or what's called it is suppressed after doing fat suppression. It means that this lesion contains fat, or it is a fat. When the high signal here becomes black, as we can see here, it means it is a fat. So it is a fat containing lesion. It is a case of angiomyolipoma here. And when doing MRI, we can see here, this is an aneurysm inside. It is a common complication to see a hematoma and aneurysms inside the angiomyolipoma. So this is an MRI with contrast, and we can see there is a large vascular lesion here inside the angiomyolipoma. It is an MRI with a contrast that confirms that there is a large lesion with fat containing lesion after doing fat suppression and drop of signal intensity of the lesion. And at contrast enhanced MRI, we can see this is a large aneurysm inside the lesion. This is an MR angiography, and this is a large circular aneurysm inside the lesion. This is the left renal artery here, and this is the large aneurysm inside the lesion. What about the MRU? MRU is the most important technique used in neuroradiology. It has a good diagnostic value virtually all kinds of urinary tract disorders. MRU used in evaluation of the kidneys, especially for diagnosis of urinary obstruction, the course of the ureter, and if there is abnormalities in the pelvic cell system and ureter and the bladder. It needs no contrast in most of the cases, but in some indications we can need MRU with contrast. What are types of MRU techniques? We have two main types of MRU. First type used T2 weighted MRU. It is an T2 weighted MRU urography. No need for contrast for T2 weighted MRU. We have two techniques, T2 weighted technique and the T1 weighted technique. T2 weighted technique, it depends upon imaging of the fluid inside the pelvic cell system. It used mainly for evaluation of hydronephrosis. So T2 weighted MRU, no need to inject contrast. It just used to evaluate the dilated urinary tract. The other technique is the T1 weighted MRU, or what is called excretory MRU. At this T1 weighted technique, we inject gadolinium and then image the pelvic cell system after excretion of contrast inside the pelvic cell system and ureter. It mimics the intravenous urography or CT urography. At intravenous urography, conventional intravenous urography or CT urography, we inject contrast and waiting for excretion of contrast, and then do imaging of the calyces, the ureter, and the bladder. So T1-weighted or excretory MRU, it mimics intravenous urography or CT urography. We inject gadolinium and giving time for the kidney to excrete gadolinium, 3-4 minutes. And then we do imaging of the urinary tract using T1-weighted technique. At T1, in conventional T1, the fluid is flow signal intensity or dark or of dark signal intensity. So after injection of contrast, the dark fluid inside the pelvic cell system will be bright. After injection of contrast, the fluid will be bright and will be imaged easily at T1 weighted image. But at T2 weighted image, the fluid is bright or of high signal intensity. So we use the T2 weighted technique to visualize or to for imaging the pelvic or for imaging of the urinary tract directly. This is an example technique. This is an example for T2 weighted MRI. How can I know this is a T2? From this is the CSF here. The fluid is bright. This is not injective contrast. It is a T2 weighted technique. So the fluid inside the spine here or the CSF here is bright. So it is a T2 weighted technique. I can see this is an obstructed kidney here. The right kidney is obstructed down to a structure. This is the fluid inside the urinary bladder. So it is a T2 or what is called the static MRU. Static MRU. And we can see, oh, this is an example also for this is a static MRU. This is a T2 weighted MRU. And this is the fluid inside the spine. This is the bladder. And this is the fluid hydronephrotic kidney and the dilated pelvic cell system down to a structure. The advantage of MRU or static MRU or T2 weighted MRU that we do not need to inject contrast. We don't need to inject contrast at T2 weighted MRU. It may take a long time. We have two techniques, but it is maybe not so important for the non-radiologist. It may be a single shot technique. It's a very fast technique. It takes about few seconds, and can be used the image for the severely ill patients. It can detect if there is obstruction or no obstruction and at the level of obstruction, but the details of anatomy will be difficult to be assessed at this technique. There is another technique, what's called the multi-slice T2 weighted technique. The multi-slice T2 techniques, it takes more longer time, about 3 to 4 minutes. And we get many sections for the kidney, as we can see here. Then we do what's called the reformatted image. But we can see here, we can see the details of anatomy here of the kidney at this multi-slice technique. But in general, this is a T2 weighted MRU urography used for evaluation of the obstruction. And in some cases, we can detect the level of, in most of cases, we can detect the actual level of obstruction and the cause of obstruction. This is another example for T2 weighted MR urography, static T2 MR urography. We use the T2 weighted technique, no injection of contrast. We do just imaging of the kidney using T2 technique, and we can see the details of anatomy here of the kidney. We can see this is a normal right kidney, hydronephrotic left kidney. We get serial images for the kidney here, and then we do what's called the reformatted image. We can see here, this is the marked hydronephrosis. This is the ureter down to the bladder here, and this is a normal right kidney. Can see the fluid here inside the spinal cord, the CSF inside the spinal cord, and this is the bladder. It is a technique used without injection of contrast. This is the T2 multi-slice T2 weighted technique. The disadvantage of this technique is a slightly longer time, and the advantage is the higher resolution. This technique, what's called the single shot technique, takes few seconds, 5 seconds, this technique, just 5 seconds, but no details of anatomy you can see. Just we can,
the only information that there is a marked hydronephrosis at the left kidney. But at this technique, at the multi-slice technique, we can see this is the marked hydronephrosis down to the structure inside the lower end of the ureter. But the multi-slice technique, we can give only an idea about the degree of hydronephrosis and if there is hydronephrosis or no. We can see here, we can see the right kidney here, but at multi-slice technique, we can see the right kidney. But both are T2 weighted or what is called static MR urography of the urinary tract. So as we said, we have two techniques, T2 weighted technique and T1 weighted technique. T1, as we said, it is the excretory MR urography. It mimics or imitates the conventional intravenous urography. We inject contrast and waiting for excretion of contrast. The low signal intensity of the fluid will become high signal intensity and will be imaged at using T1 weighted technique. This is T2 technique. This is a T2 technique, T2 MR urography. The fluid here inside the CSF. But at this image, no fluid inside, or no fluid. We can see the CSF here. So it is a T1 technique. And why this bright? Because we inject gadolinium. Gadolinium injected here. But here, this is a T2 weighted technique. Only the fluid containing organs will be visualized. We can see the CSF, we can see the bladder, we can see the hydronephrotic right kidney. The left kidney not visualized because no hydronephrosis at the left kidney, but we can see here marked hydronephrosis at the right kidney. The cause of obstruction may be pelvourethral narrowing here, but after injection of contrast, we can see here, this is the T1 weighted technique. The contrast is secreted and there is a marked hydronephrosis at the kidney with obstruction at the pelvourethral junction. And this is a normal kidney here after excretion of contrast. This is the ureter, normal ureter visualized down to its lower end. And this is a bladder filled with gadolinium enhanced urine here. So this is the difference between T2 technique and the T1 technique. T1, we will need to inject gadolinium to visualize the pelvic lesial system and the ureter and the bladder if there is adequate function of the kidney. The gadolinium will be excreted and will opacify the pelvic lesial system, ureter, and the bladder. But at T2 weighted technique, no injection of contrast. So it depends upon the fluid content inside the kidney to visualize the kidney, ureter, and the bladder. If no hydronephrosis, the kidney will not be visualized, except if we did distension to the pelvic lesial system using diuresis. We can inject some diuresis to just do distension of the pelvic lesial system and visualize the normal system. But at T2, it is used mainly for detection and diagnosing of hydronephrosis. So we discussed in general T1 weighted MRI, T2 weighted MRI, its application of the kidney, and gadolinium enhanced and MR urography by its two techniques, excretory T1 weighted MR urography and static T2 weighted MR urography. Other techniques that nowadays gets a wide acceptance and it is used as a routine nowadays in evaluation of the urinary tract is a diffusion-weighted MR urography. Free diffusion of fluid inside the cells and inside the blood vessels, as we can see here, this is the normal movement of fluid molecules inside and outside the cells here. This is normal, and if there is a free movement, there will be no abnormal signal intensity at diffusion-weighted images. But if there is a restriction of diffusion, if there is a pathology such as tumor, such as ischemia, such as infection, it will lead to restriction of diffusion or destruction of the cell wall and restriction of the diffusion or increase the viscosity of the cells, or it will lead to restriction of diffusion. In malignancy, there will be increased number of cells and will restrict the diffusion. In ischemia, edema, cytotoxic edema, and in abscess, increased viscosity all will lead to restriction of diffusion. At diffusion-weighted images, and normally there will be no signal, but if there is abnormal high signal at diffusion-weighted images, it means that there is a restriction of diffusion. And as we said, the restriction may be due to malignancy, may be due to ischemia, or may be due to infection. So if there is a high signal intensity at diffusion-weighted image, there it means that there is a pathology, either malignancy, ischemia, or abscess. So for more confirmation or for more characterization of the lesion, we do what's called apparent diffusion coefficient, what's called apparent diffusion coefficient or EDC map. It's used for qualitative and quantitative evaluation of the lesion in addition to diffusion-weighted images. It is done from diffusion-weighted images. The machine automatically calculates the EDC map. And in cases of pathology, the diffusion-weighted image is of high signal intensity and the ADC map of low signal intensity. It means that there is a pathology. Usually it may be a cancer, but it may be also be an infection or maybe ischemia, as we will see in the different examples later. This is a diffusion-weighted sequence here. This is the diffusion-weighted sequence. But this is a T1-weighted images of a renal tumor. This is a large, huge renal mass here with a large renal vein thrombus here. And to confirm, this is a large heterogeneous mass at the kidney with a thrombus extending into the IVC. And this is after injection of contrast. A diffusion-weighted image without injection of contrast. And this is a very simple and fast technique. It takes about 2 minutes. We can confirm that there is a presence of a lesion here, a tumor with a thrombus extending into the IVC at the diffusion-weighted MRI. This is another example here also. This is a T2-weighted MR. How I know this is a T2? This is a CSF inside the spine of high signal intensity. It means that this is a T2-weighted image. And this is a T1-weighted image. The fluid inside the spine here is black. So this is a T2. This is a lesion here of heterogeneous high signal intensity at T2, of heterogeneous intermediate signal intensity at T1. And after injection of contrast, the lesion shows mild enhancement. But at diffusion-weighted MRI, I can see here, this is the lesion of high signal intensity at diffusion-weighted image. This is the ADC map. I can see this is a lesion of low signal intensity. It means that it is mostly a renal tumor, and it is a very rapid and fast techniques, and add more value for characterization of the lesion, for add more value for the T1 and the T2 techniques. This is an example of the polycystic kidney that we see before. This is enlarged kidneys with multiple cysts here, bilateral multiple renal cysts, and this is the lesion here of low signal intensity. As we said, this is a large hemorrhagic cyst, and we can see here at diffusion-weighted image, it is of low signal intensity at diffusion, so it means that there is no restriction. It is not a tumor or not a cyst with infection or infected content. So if there is no malignancy at diffusion-weighted image, the cyst will appear, or the lesion will appear of low signal intensity. But if there is a pathology, such as tumor, the lesion appears of high signal or restricted diffusion at T2 at diffusion-weighted images. But no malignancy, as we can see, this hemorrhagic cyst, no restriction of signal, and this lesion appears of low signal intensity. Another example, this is here a lesion of restricted diffusion or high signal intensity at diffusion-weighted images. It means this is mostly a renal tumor. It is a pelvicalcial tumor here. The bladder also uretic tumor of whether a diffusion restriction of high signal intensity. Bladder tumor can be diagnosed without injection of contrast and easily diagnosed here, and it is used nowadays as a routine in our center for diagnosis of bladder tumor without injection of contrast here. This is a restriction of high signal intensity inside the bladder. This is a bladder tumor, as we can see here, a T2 weighted image, the fluid in the ureter is of high signal intensity. And this is a restriction of a signal here at the bladder. It means that it is a bladder tumor. So the first part, we discussed the different techniques used for, at MRI in routine evaluation of the kidney, the T1, the T2, the MR urography, and MR with contrast, and diffusion-weighted MRI. Nowadays, we will discuss how or what is the indications of MR in nephrology, how we can use MRI in nephrology. This is the basics or the routine techniques used for evaluation of the kidney. First, what is called all-in-one approach. This technique used for evaluation of potential left donor and for evaluation of transplanted kidney, sometimes in cases of urinary tract obstruction or before surgery, but mainly for nephrologists, it is used for evaluation of the kidney donors, potential donors before transplantation, and for evaluation of kidneys post-transplantation. What is the meaning of all-in-one approach? As this technique we used to do evaluation of the kidney, all-in-one technique, we do sequences, routine sequences, T2, T1, MR urography for evaluation of the kidney without contrast. Then we do MR angiography, as this is a case of kidney donor. This is an MR angiography using gadolinium enhanced MR angiography after injection of gadolinium. This is the aorta. This is the right renal. This is the left renal artery. This is the right renal artery. This is the right kidney. This is the left kidney, not visualized adequately. But this is the right renal artery here with the full details of anatomical details of the right renal artery. And this is the left renal artery. So this is an MR arteriography. This is an early MR images after injection of gadolinium at MR angiography. First, we do MR arteriography. Then we do MR venography later here. This is another example, MR arteriography. Multiple vessels, double left renal arteries and double right renal arteries here with a small accessory here arising from this right renal artery here. This is the first renal right renal artery. This is the second right renal artery. This is the small accessory here. And this is the double left renal arteries, as we can see here. Then we do what's called MR nephrography for evaluation of the renal parenchyma and for evaluation of the renal veins. This is a retroaortic left renal vein here, and this is the renal parenchyma can be evaluated here. This is another example or also for MR all-in-one approach. We can see here, this is the MR angiography and MR nephrography for evaluation of the renal parenchyma. And this is an MR urography after excretion of contrast. So an all-in-one approach, we do MR arteriography, MR venography, MR nephrography, and MR urography for evaluation of the urinary tract before transplantation for evaluation of potential live donor. We do MR angiography for evaluation of the renal arteries and the veins, MR nephrography for evaluation of the renal parenchyma. We can see here, this is a small cyst here of low signal intensity because we do MR angiography in T1 technique. So this is a small cyst of low signal intensity, and this after 3 minutes after excretion of contrast inside the pelvic LCL system, we can get this image for the pelvic LCL system after excretion of gadolinium inside the kidney and the ureter and the blood. So this is our all-in-one approach for evaluation of the potential donor, also for evaluation of kidney transplant after transplantation. I can see here also, this is the same technique, MR angiography. This is a transplanted kidney. This is the aorta, and this is the transplanted kidney artery here and the vein. And this is the MR nephrography for evaluation of the renal parenchyma, and the MR urography for evaluation of the pelvic LCL system, ureter, and the bladder of transplanted kidney. Another example also, this is an MR arteriography for double arterial supply of transplanted kidney, and this is an MR urography waiting for excretion of contrast 2 to 3 minutes in normal kidney and evaluation of the kidney. Another indication of MR is the MR urography. It is used for evaluation of the kidneys, if it is obstructed or non-obstructed, if there is a pelvic LCL tumor or urothelial tumor, the cause of obstruction, and for evaluation if there is a congenital anomalies. As we said, we have two techniques of MR urography, either MR urography with contrast or T2 weighted MR urography without contrast, and T1 weighted MR urography. So this is a T2 weighted MR urography, and we know that this is a T2 because we can see here the CSF fluid of high signal intensity, but at this image no CSF appears here. This is the same case, this is the same patient. So no CSF here of high, so it means that it is a T2, and we can see hydronephrotic kidney here, but the left kidney not visualized. This is one of the drawbacks of single shot MR urography. You can't visualize the normal structure normally. So this is a T2, just there is a hydronephrosis at the left, at the right kidney, and this is a left kidney not visualized. It means that no hydronephrosis at the left kidney. But this technique is T1 or excretory MR urography. When I use T1, it means that this is an MR with gadolinium. As we can see here, the kidney is still functioning. Despite the marked hydronephrosis, the kidney, the gadolinium excreted here at the kidney, and where there is an arrest of contrast at the stricture here at the lower end ureter. We can see there is a tight stricture here at the lower end of the ureter. But in contrary to the left kidney, we can see here at the static MRU, we can see here there is excretion of contrast as the normal left kidney, normal calyces here, the duplicated kidney, there is a duplex, duplicated pelvic LCL system, but no hydronephrosis at the kidney. So this is the T2 weighted MR urography. How can I know that this is, it is a T2? The CSF inside the spine, it means it is a T2, and the hydronephrotic kidney, the fluid inside the hydronephrotic kidney visualized, and the bladder. This is a T1, no CSF appears, and this is the gadolinium excreted by both kidneys and opacifying the pelvic LCL system and ureters at both kidneys. This is an intravenous urography. This is an injection of iodinated contrast and conventional imaging of the kidney. We can see here there is a stone and no excretion of contrast by the right kidney, but this is a normal left kidney at intravenous urography. At MRU, this is a T2 weighted MRU or static MRU. We can see the fluid inside the spine, the CSF inside the spine. We can, this is hydronephrotic kidney, marked hydronephrosis with the stone. As we said, calcification appear as a signal void. So T2 weighted image without injection of contrast, we can visualize the hydronephrosis inside the kidney here and down to a signal void stone inside the ureter. Also, MRI required for evaluation of congenital anomalies. there is a variable or a multiple variations of congenital anomalies as the kidney. As we can see here, this is a kidney with multiple, with a triple kidneys. This both at intravenous urography, we can see both kidneys at normal position, but there is another abnormal structure with abnormal here. It means it possibly a kidney, ectopic kidney, third ectopic kidney. We need a cross-sectional imaging to confirm either CT or MR. MR here with gadolinium, we can see here, this is a kidney, normal right and left kidney, and this is an ectopic third kidney here at the pelvis. This is an MRU with gadolinium. No CSF appears here. So this is the gadolinium excreted by the left, by the right kidney, gadolinium at the left kidney, and this is the ectopic kidney at third ectopic kidney at. It is one of the rare congenital anomalies. Also anomalies of position, such as ectopia. It may be simple or cross simple ectopia, as the kidney will be at the same side, but across the ectopia, the kidney will cross to the other side. As we can see here, left across the ectopia fused. This is the right kidney. This is the left kidney. The left kidney crossing and diffusing, crossing the midline and diffused with the right kidney. Another example or simple ectopia here. We can see this is the ectopic left kidney, but at the same site, no cross to the other side. And this is the normal right kidney. We can see here ectopic kidney with hydronephrosis inside. Here another example. This is T2-weighted MR urography, MR without injection of contrast. And we can see this is the ectopic kidney in the pelvis. Also for multiple cystic lesion in the kidney, if it is a polycystic kidney or it is a renal dysplasia, as in this pediatric case, we can see here multiple cysts replacing the kidney, but no intervening normal tissue, just fibrosis, no intervening normal parenchyma. It means that there is no normal parenchymal tissue between the cysts. It means that it is a dysplastic kidney, multicystic dysplastic kidney with pelvourethral junction obstruction at the left side. But in case of polycystic kidney, we can see there is a kidney. Sometimes we can see the presence of renal parenchyma between the tissues. This is a case of polycystic kidney disease with multiple cysts replacing the kidney. We can see here there is a lesion between the cysts here at both sides. When we do fat suppression technique, the lesion become black here. There is a suppression or drop of signal intensity inside the lesion. It means that it is a fat. So it is an angiomalyoma associated with polycystic kidney disease. The cysts, the fluid at fat suppression is still of high signal intensity. It means that it is a fluid. And the fat, there is a drop of signal intensity inside the fat. It's a case of polycystic kidney with associated with angiomalyoma at both sides. In autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease, as we say, this is a multiple cysts replacing the kidney with normal renal parenchyma. We can see the normal renal parenchyma with multiple cysts in this infant, child with multiple cysts at the kidneys with normal renal parenchyma in case of autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease. While in autosomal recessive, the kidneys, as we can see, still here of normal size, this young age patient, but in this infant baby, we can see this is enlarged kidneys with dense foci at the kidney at ultrasound and diffuse low signal intensity of the renal medulla at CT. It suggests highly suggestive autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease. Also diffuse high signal intensity at the renal parenchyma at both kidneys. It is diffuse high signal intensity of the renal medulla. It means that and the tubular pattern of the renal parenchyma, it means that it is a macrocyst replacing the kidney. Here it is a case of autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease. And when we see at the liver, there is a dilatation of the bile ducts. It's an association between autosomal recessive kidney disease and associated with dilatation of the bile ducts at the liver. So in cystic dysplasia, there will be no normal renal parenchyma. In autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease, we can see the renal parenchyma. Another example for using MR for evaluation of in imaging of the kidney is using the MR angiography on evaluation of vascular renal disease. This is an example of a case of renal artery stenosis, as we can see here in transplanted kidney with renal artery stenosis. We can see here, this is a graft artery with marked narrowing here at MR angiography with contrast. And this is the conventional angiography during intervention. We can see this is the marked narrowing of at the site of anastomosis between the internal iliac artery. This is an end-to-end anastomosis between the internal iliac artery and the graft artery with marked stenosis. This is the catheter here inside the artery here. But this is MR angiography. Non-invasive techniques. This is the internal iliac artery with end-to-end anastomosis to the graft artery. Another example also for renal artery stenosis, bilateral renal artery stenosis at MR angiography. We can see here bilateral marked narrowing of renal arteries in the case of bilateral renal artery stenosis at MR angiography. This is the coronal. This is axial images, MR with gadolinium enhanced MR angiography of the renal arteries. Another example also here for bilateral renal arteries here. This is a narrowing here at the left ostium of the left renal artery with marked narrowing at the right side. Also at coronal images, we can see here the marked dilated collaterals here around the right renal artery with marked narrowing. And there is here also a stenosis at the ostium of the left renal artery. This is a 3D reformatted images. And this is a 3D images, volume rendering images. This is a narrowing at the left renal artery with marked narrowing at the right one. And this is at the conventional angiography. We can see here, this is the narrowing at the ostium of the left renal artery, marked narrowing at the right renal artery with dilated collaterals around it at conventional or catheter angiography. Also for diagnosis of inflammatory lesion, MR can be used for evaluation of inflammatory renal lesion, such as this case of renal abscess. At renal abscess at T2, the fluid inside the abscess of high signal intensity and of intermediate signal intensity at T1, this is the T1 CSF of low signal intensity. At T2, it is of high signal intensity. Here, this is the CSF high, so it is T2. And this is the T1. And after injection of contrast, we can see this is a marginal enhancement of the lesion. It means that it's a marginal enhancing lesion. It is an inflammatory lesion. So it is a renal abscess of high signal intensity here at T2, intermediate signal intensity at T1, and marginal enhancement after injection of contrast. Another example of acute pyelonephritis here. This is bilateral cystic lesion at the kidneys. And after injection of contrast here, this is a tubular pattern, a tubular nephrographic pattern of the kidney. It means it is a case of acute pyelonephritis. Also a case of pyelonephritis with bilateral renal abscesses here at T2, T1, and at T1 with contrast. We can see bilateral pyelonephritis with bilateral renal abscesses. What is about the kidney transplant? How can MR used for evaluation of kidney transplant? MRU can be used for evaluation if there is a complication post-transplantation, such as this is a fluid, a T2-weighted MR. We can see here a fluid outside the kidney, outside the bladder here. And this is a track, a T2 outside the bladder to confirm that there is a leak from the site of ureteric anastomosis with the bladder, we inject contrast. There is a leak of contrast here. This is, these images is MR with contrast after injection of gadolinium. We can see here, this is the MR urography of transplanted kidney. And we can see here, this is the site of the ureteric anastomosis with the bladder with leak of contrast as the site of anastomosis. Also, this is the track of urine leak here. So it is, this is a case of kidney transplant with urine leak at the site of anastomosis between the ureter and the bladder. Also, ureteric structure, a hydronephrotic kidney here. This is an MR with gadolinium. This is a kidney adequate function. There is just distension of the calyces or mild dilatation with structure at the lower end ureter. No contrast passes to the bladder. Means it is a tight structure at the lower end ureter. This is an MR urography with gadolinium. Also, this is a case of acute rejection with marked necrosis, necrotic tissue, marked necrosis or destruction of the renal parenchyma. The kidney, there is a subcortical necrosis of the renal parenchyma in case of acute rejection. Another example, this is a small focal lesion in kidney transplant patient with just complaining of low-grade fever. This is a small lesion. This is the lesion of intermediate signal intensity at T2 and T1 with mild post-contrast enhancement. And there is a small, just a distortion for the perinephric fat. So the case suggests that it is a case of focal nephritis. This is the primary suggestion. And the recommendation for a therapeutic test. So 1 week after giving an antibiotic, there is complete resolution of the lesion here. The lesion here, focal nephritis, it can be differentiated with renal tumor. Just 1 week treatment and redoing MRI, there is complete resolution of the lesion. It means that it is a case of infection. And the diagnosis, the primary diagnosis of focal nephritis was accurate. And after 1 week of therapeutic antibiotic, there is complete resolution of the lesion. Another example of a kidney transplant with a large mass inside. There is a large tumor at the transplanted kidney here. So this is a case of kidney transplant with a large mass renal cell carcinoma in a transplanted kidney. One of complications of transplant and immunosuppression here. An example, as we said, high signal intensity at diffusion-weighted MRI and low signal intensity at ADC MAB, it may be a tumor, it may be an ischemia, or it may be an infection. In a case with multiple vessels, we have to suggest that the first suggestion is that it is ischemic changes due to sacrificing a small vessel supplying the upper bowel or polar arteries in case of multiple kidney with multiple blood supply. So in case of diffusion with the image with diffusion restriction, it is a case of ischemic changes at the upper and lower bowels of the kidney. Another example of a case of acute tubular necrosis. So this is a tubular pattern or mosaic pattern suggests that it is an acute tubular necrosis or obstructed tubules at in case of acute tubular necrosis. So diffusion-weighted MRI can be used to suggest that there may be the underlying pathology of the kidney. Lastly, we will discuss simply the nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. Nephrogenic systemic fibrosis is an uncommon condition. There will be a fibrous plaques that deposition of vascular plaques in the dermis. It is reported in some cases, but the recently published papers nowadays suggests that the risk of gadolinium not so high as was reported before, especially in stage 4 and 5 chronic disease, as we can see at this publication published in February at this year. They classified the gadolinium into three groups, group 1, group 2, and group 3. And that they found that in there is a gadolinium-based contrast agent has had an excellent safety recorded over the past 3 decades. The risk of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis not so high. In group 1, this group 1 with linear non-ionic group may have some risk for developing nephrogenic systemic fibrosis in stage 4 and 5 kidney disease, but group 2, the macrocyclic non-ionic groups is safe and no reported cases in patients with acute kidney injury in CKD of stage 4 or 5 and or those on dialysis. The manifestation of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis, usually it will be pain, pruritus, erythema, maybe thickening of subcutaneous tissue and fibrosis later with, and it will lead to contracture, cachexia, and later on maybe a death of a patient. It usually the risk of gadolinium in patient was less than 30 milli GFR, less than 30 milli per minute, but the risk, as we said, not so high with using the macrocyclic non-ionic group. We have to take care in patient with lactating patient. They should stop lactation 24 hours after gadolinium. Also in pregnant women, it's better to avoid gadolinium during pregnancy. If we can avoid gadolinium, it will be better than using it during pregnancy. As we said, gadolinium, if we need to inject gadolinium in patient with high serum creatinine, we have to be restricted to a very low dose and consider immediate post-scan dialysis. It is better to do 3 sessions for 3 days after injection of gadolinium in patient with high risk for developing our patient with high risk with stage 4 and 5 kidney chronic kidney disease. The recommendation for European Society of Urogenital Radiology is never deny a patient with clinically indicated enhanced MRI eye examination due to the risk of developing NSF. In all patients, we have to use the smallest amount of contrast medium necessary for diagnostic results. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope to see you in the second part about the advances of MRI in nephrology. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank and appreciate the presence of Professor Abou El-Ghar with us this night. Really, it is a fantastic presentation. And one of the merits and advantage of this presentation is all MRI images included in this presentation are belonging to Professor Abou El-Ghar. So this is why you don't find any reference written in the slides, because this is his own MRI images. And I think we will take few minutes to 10 minutes or 15 minutes for discussion. And we have question in the chat. I'll start with the question in the chat. So here we have the questions. The first, we have two questions here in the chat for Dr. Abou El-Ghar. The first question, can MRU replace micturating cystic erythrogram to detect if hydronephrosis due to reflux? You can speak loudly from now.
Not MR urography, but we can do MR cystography nowadays. We can inject gadolinium inside, but this is maybe sometime difficult due to the special status of the magnet and the MR. But we can do MR, or in some centers they do MR MR cystography, inject gadolinium inside the bladder and image the kidney. Or image the urinary tract after filling the bladder with gadolinium enhanced saline. But MR urography per se not replace the micturating cyst urography.
The second question is the role of MRU in evaluation vesicle reflux, the same, you answered the question of Dr. Hoda. Please include the MRI artifact in the next lecture regarding the MRI artifact. Okay. So this is a very specific for radiology. It seems this is a question from radiology side. I like to have questions or comment from Professor Faisal Shaheen.
Thank you very much. It is excellent talk. And as you said, Hussein, it takes a lot of new experience, actually. Even for us, it is a very good picture, new for us, and it is not it's not as usual talk. But I wonder if I will continue the same question with someone else. Is this MRI is going to limit our request for isotope rhinogram and DTBA in the future, or it is already limiting this? And also intravenous urogram, as we were asking for my guest. Is this is going to limit all of this? This is one thing. The other things which I was looking to hear it from you about the risk index to develop end-stage renal disease and polycystic kidney disease using MRI technique, or you have a special equation for that?
So, Dr. Faisal, the first question was?
The first question was continued. It's going to limit the isotope rhinogram.
Yes, I think it will be the second part, inshallah. It will be the second part for functional MR. This is now, it is worldwide. This is a very important issue that you use the MR in evaluation of the renal function. It is used in many centers nowadays for evaluation of renal function. I think maybe in the near future, it will replace the rhinogram. Already we do what's called dynamic contrast enhanced MR in normal kidneys nowadays for evaluation of the renal parenchyma and can calculate the percentage of renal function adequately. Calculation of GFR can be done at MR nowadays, but it needs some complicated equations. It needs still need more improvement to be more simplified technique to use in general, to use nowadays in the level of research. And I think it is adequate results from the functional MR in evaluation of the renal function.
Regarding this point, Professor Shaheen, I think as nephrologists nowadays, we limit the request for renogram. And the only indication from my perspective is to diagnose, is it obstructive system or not? And I think that when MRI becomes more simple, because we shouldn't neglect the claustrophobic effects of MRI, I think it will replace altogether the rhinogram. I don't like doing the rhinogram, abusing rhinogram, because for perfusion images, even we can look at the perfusion of the kidney by Doppler ultrasound. So I think with optimization, simplicity of MRI, the role of phrenogram will be limited, and I think it will be limited for the obstruction role only, because those who are biased to phrenogram give us presentations about the value of phrenogram to diagnose renal function, rejection, and everything. But nowadays, we request phrenogram just to see is it obstructive curve or not? Your second question, yes. Professor.
It is about polycystic kidney disease and risk index to develop end-stage renal disease. This is radiological things. Yes, okay.
Nowadays, we have a large project what's about the biomarkers and biomarkers for chronic kidney disease, including polycystic kidney disease. This is subtitled from this project. We nowadays going to collect the data from different centers for polycystic kidney disease, and we get the biomarkers that who will develop can develop. Yes. Who will develop chronic kidney disease and those who is maintained with renal function. Nowadays, we use mainly the volumetry of the renal cyst and correlate the size of the cyst and the kidney with the deterioration of the renal function. I think we're still working. It is a large group from Europe and from USA, and I think from the Middle East only. This center from Egypt is the only center working with this group. We do a large project about the biomarkers for chronic kidney disease at different diseases. And I think the results will be available in the near future for this, but not till now, no biomarkers except the size of the kidney and the size of the cyst.
So just in a simple word, to add to Professor for the issue of polycystic kidney disease, all randomized clinical trial done, the mega trial done in polycystic kidney disease, accustomed to use MR to measure the cyst and the volume of the kidney. And this is an index for even selecting tolvaptan or vaptans in management of polycystic kidney disease based on the evaluation of the kidney and the cyst by MRI. So it is very valuable technique for monitoring polycystic kidney disease. And I think it is devoid of radiation and more accurate, and the system may be automated for measuring all volumes. So this is advantage over CT scan because we don't like total radiation. We have with us Professor Donia, and he is one of the very smart doctors. He doesn't like the radiation of CT scan because CT scan is full of radiation. This is why I prefer to hear from Professor Donia and get back to Professor Shaheen. Dr. Donia. Unmute yourself, Dr.
Thank you, Professor Hussein. And I'd like to thank Professor Abou El-Ghar. Amazing talk as usual. I have personally learned a lot and I'm really eager to attend the second part. A question about nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. Mohamed, as a nephrologist, we have a concern about using gadolinium in CKD patients. And I think the situation in our center is a little bit reversed. We are still concerned about nephrogenic systemic fibrosis, and you and your colleagues in radiology department are more brave to use it. So just a clarification about group one and group two contrasts. What's the prevalence in your opinion the use of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis in group two contrasts, and what's the prevalence of using group two contrasts in radiology centers in general? Do you think that now group one is not used anymore, or we are still using it in some centers? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof.
For your question, I think most of the centers nowadays use the group two. Most of centers use the group two
I think in our center we use group 2 macrocyclic from many, many years because the debates about the group 1, maybe in some private centers, I don't know if they use group 1, but in most of the centers, even it is prohibited nowadays, and I think no use for group 1. The prevalence of group 2, we have no reported cases. Over 15 years, we have no reported cases with group 2. I think maybe with group 1, when starting MR, there may be only one case reported. All over the world, I think the reported no reports nowadays for new cases of NSF. I think the paper that I present, there is a safety of MR is of high safety, but they recommend, still recommend to use group 2 with CKD, group 4 and group 5. And I think with group 2 macrocyclic gadolinium, I think it is safe, but still there is some restriction if we can if we will use gadolinium, or if there is an a high indication for to use gadolinium with group 4 or group 5, we need to use the minimum dose. It is a very, very important recommendation to use the minimum dose, 0.1 milli per kg, millimole per kg. The second, if we can do post injection dialysis sessions for 3 sessions immediately after, for over 3 days immediately after gadolinium injection, it will be better. But still, as I said before, it is still safe, and no reports about NSF at group 2 gadolinium based contrast agent.
If you allow me, Dr. Dunya, Dr. Ahmed, are you still with us? Dr. Dunya, okay. I would like to add just a point. When we change it from gadolinium to the newer agents, we are confident about the safety of the new versions of gadolinium. But I think the Canadian guidelines are very brave, even saying that with the new gadolinium, especially group 2, no need to monitor kidney function. They are very brave. But for the annals of internal medicine, there is caution to have longer follow-up for the patients and to wait. And I think the wisdom of that mentioned by Professor Abou El-Ghar to use very small dose, because the problem is dose dependent, I think it be very important, plus using the second generation of gadolinium. And I think nowadays there is another problem rather than nephrogenic systemic fibrosis, which is the gadolinium retention syndrome, retention in brain, muscles, and others. And up till now, there are some controversy about this syndrome. And I think we will clarify all these issues in the second part of the of MRI and the kidney. Professor Shaheen, do you have other points to add?
Yes, just the last point, because it is very important issue about dialyzing the patient after gadolinium in stage 4 or something. Is it necessary if I have some patient who had creatinine, whatever, is it 4 or 5, and he had contrast, and then his creatinine is still almost the same or less, or his urine output is good after gadolinium? Is it necessary to dialyze him and to give him a shock of dialysis?
For a stage 4, no. For a stage 4, no. Use the second generation. And that's it, the smallest dose as possible. But it is very traumatic to do dialysis for a stage 4 CKD. But dialysis is a wisdom for patients on hemodialysis and regular dialysis with no result. So if the patient even in Britannia dialysis, but all these advices are expert opinion and based on the old generations of gadolinium for gadolinium. To do hemodialysis instead of Britannia dialysis, for patient dialyze through BD, and for hemodialysis patients, it is not only one session, but to do, as Professor Blar mentioned, 3 consecutive daily dialysis to get rid of 95% of gadolinium because it can be removed by extensive hemodialysis. So this is for dialysis patient, but I cannot, and I don't know if there is any expert in the world recommends or advise or suggests to do dialysis for patients with CKD stage 4 before dialysis. Okay. So
thank you.
Second generation, okay. Small dose.
It's clear. It's clear because Dr. Awad actually mentioned stage 4, visualize him, which I think okay. It will be very early.
Okay. Thank you very much. Dr. Saeed Khamis.
Thank you.
Thank you, Basha. Dr. Saeed.
Hussein, and thanks for this elegant lecture. By I have 3 comments, if you allow me. Number one, if the patient, especially for my junior colleagues, if the patient received gadolinium and checked for calcium in the serum, it can be very low falsely. I mean, pseudo hypocalcemia. It's not true because it interact with the assay of the calcium. That's number one. Number two,
regarding this point, side, yes, I agree with you. If we have the patients after doing MR with gadolinium, MRI with contrast or MRA, it is better not to check serum calcium, especially if the serum calcium is evaluated by calorimetric method, because it interferes with calorimetry method, leading to severe hypocalcemia. So you can find the patient with total calcium 3 mg/dL, and without manifestations, without tetany, without parathesia, nothing. But because he was exposed to gadolinium within a few hours, so please don't, we shouldn't order serum calcium after doing gadolinium.
Yes, it will give hypocalcemia.
It will be fallacious, especially if we use calorimetric method for measuring serum calcium.
Yeah.
Second comment to Dr. Saeed.
Yeah, one slide shown by Dr. Professor Barr is bilateral angiomyolipoma and cystic kidney. I think it is typical of this tuberous sclerosis, maybe. Am I right, Professor Abou El-Ghar?
Yes, yes, it's a case of tuberous sclerosis.
The third comment regarding gadolinium nephrotoxicity.
It is mostly tuberous sclerosis, Dr. Saeed. It is mostly. But we should complete the stigmata of tuberous sclerosis by looking at the brain, lung, others, and epilepsy. So this is to put in consideration, yes.
This last comment regarding the nephrotoxicity of gadolinium, despite it is much less than the iodinated contrast, but it's still there. I mean, AKI can occur secondary to gadolinium, I think. What is your opinion, Professor Borgar?
I think,
thank you so much.
Yes, there is a nephrotoxicity for the gadolinium, but it is with high dose gadolinium. Yeah, it is reported in high dose gadolinium and the case with renal impairment. But in general, and with the new MR machines, we use the minimum dose. Nowadays, the new MR machines allowed us to use a very, very minimum dose of gadolinium. So it is not reported, not so much reported nowadays for, it may be reported in some cases we need to do angiography with high dose gadolinium. But with routine investigations, we use minimum dose of gadolinium that not carry any risk of nephrotoxicity.
Thank you, Professor.
I think the presentation was fantastic, and it is a real atlas for MRI, reflecting the major experience that Professor Blar has in doing this job, and he is biased to MRI, and he is enthusiastic to MRI, and we agree with him because the last decade witnessed major advances in MRI, and this will be clarified and explained in the next session, hoping to be in the near future. Because we are now late, let us this is the symbol of respect to Dr. Abou El-Ghar from the ASNT CME chapter, and we appreciate your efforts for giving us this very nice talk. It appears from the title is basic, but I think it is advanced for us. So thank you very much for this comprehensive outlook for fascinating technique of MRI. And we are eager to hear from you, your experience with the advances of MRI. And at that time, I should say goodbye. The video will be uploaded as soon as possible. Thank you and goodbye.